Ew. What is that? So, as I have mentioned a few times, I don't care about which edition of the book that you use. This is an easier one because the riddles are numbered, but I had given a lot of people this edition, and since we had a lot of trouble with Tagore figuring out what we are talking about, I use the page numbers here, but I'll mention the riddle that we're speaking of. In the last class, we talked about Ambedkar's introduction, so the introduction that Ambedkar had written, which is on pages 49 to 57 of this edition. And in our attempt to think about Indian modernity philosophically, there are many ways you can think about it. In our attempt to think about it philosophically, we heard Sri Aurobindo talk about Renaissance, and within the context of modernity. And then we heard Tagore's characters in Kanebare speak about enlightenment. Sandeep and Nikhil had a debate about what enlightenment is and how to achieve it, differing, of course, on what they argued. And you've also read Kant's short text on what is enlightenment. And what I would posit is that if you're enrolled in the course and you've chosen not to read Kant's text on the Enlightenment, that this is tantamount to making a decision not to be enlightened. Why do I say that? I say that because you have the choice to read or not to read. And how many people have that privilege? And you have access to this material that you choose not to read, but that you know has inspired countless people throughout the history of the world, all over the world. Kant's What is Enlightenment launched a project of artists and scientists and philosophers who took Kant's lead in this new orientation, which Kant referred to as daring to know. Daring to know. Because knowledge is not easy, and it's not without its dangers. And so what people who don't have access to the material, this is one case, but people who do have access to the material have a choice to be made, whether it's a courageous one of daring to know, or whether it's a cowardly one of opting out, of taking those the efforts required in order to study what has inspired so many artists and scientists and philosophers and writers and so on. So, those of you whose higher education is paid for by basically what are the toiling masses of the Indian nation, you have nominal charges to what can be a world-class education, paid for through taxation, while how many farmers commit suicide each year? Can they choose to read or not read? Are they offered occasions where this is handed to them, where a wall is built around you who are invited in at the expense of the taxpayer, and told, this is work that has inspired great minds. You have the potentiality to be one of those. That's why you're in and everybody else is out. You are the ones who have chosen not to read. So you're making a voluntary decision against enlightenment. Kant was, he was an early academic. When we think of it as academia, a place like JU, was started right around the time that Kant begins to write. Philosophers before him were not academics as we conceive of them now, generally like Hobbes or Machiavelli or Bacon or whatever. They were tutors to Aristotle, tutors to noble families, rich families, patrons, or they were bureaucrats. But Kant was an academic philosopher, and he emerged as somebody who discussed the nature of the academic institution, which got carried forward by people like Fichte, and then Hegel, and then Marx, who was an academic. Now, the academia, the university as we know it, is a modern democratic institution. It is an institution of modern democracy, representative democracy. They don't have them elsewhere. You have trade schools, you have polytechnics and things like this. But democracies are the ones that are peculiar in having academies that offer courses like philosophy. And it's an institution paid for by the masses, right? The masses, who are the demos of the democracy, pay for this institution. And there's a wall built around it to exclude them. So it's a self-exclusion process of the toiling taxpayers to keep themselves out of the institution so that you have the tranquility and the possibility to read texts like Kant's What is Enlightenment, so that you can imagine and generate alternative futures for the good of the democracy. You're an investment. You're an investment that democracy makes in the flourishing of the democratic institutions, and the university is one of those areas of investment. And you are the investment for which, you know, the budget of JNU is 200,000-300,000 crores. Between 200 and 300 crores. So you could give every farmer who's killing him or herself. That's the annual budget. So we have, what, 30,000 people killing themselves? You could give each one 10 lakhs a year. Stop the farmer suicides. Or we can invest in you. You who have chosen not to read. So the masses don't have the privilege of access. And what Amitka says in the introduction of this book is that he's writing this book because the masses don't have privileged access. Now, Ambedkar takes Kant's ideas about the Enlightenment insofar as they were institutionalized in the universities. Ambedkar takes them very seriously. I would argue much more seriously than any of us take it. He argued for a liberation through knowledge, which is an explicit passage from Kant's What is Enlightenment, liberation through knowledge. That's on page 57 of this book. He argued for it. The Enlightenment audacity to inquire, the audacity, sapere audes, that means dare to know, have the courage to learn, to know, the courage of knowledge. The last line of Ambedkar's introduction is, I know what is going to happen to me because of publishing this book, and I'm not afraid. He argued for the enlightenment of the masses, page 49. argued for a rational freedom from the grip of superstition and the fetishism of religious dogma. Now that's different from arguing against religion. He doesn't argue against religion. He argues against the fetishism of religious dogma through rational freedom. You see that these are two very different things. And the reason that he argues against the fetishism of religious dogma is because of the fetishism of religious practices, which he held to be inegalitarian, anti-democratic, and patriarchal. So as long as he esteemed that the concrete practices of the religion, the religions that were more or less available to the masses, were inegalitarian against the masses, patriarchal against half of the population, and anti-democratic against the very idea of India as a democratic republic that invests in universities where people can get liberated to knowledge. As long as he esteemed that this is what religion was doing, or how it was practiced, or the way that we were commanded dogmatically to follow its prescriptions, Ambedkar not only had he didn't make an arbitrary decision to argue against religious dogma. It was an expression of completing the project of the Enlightenment in a manner that fulfills its promise. Because the very basic premises of the Enlightenment are not technological modernity or anything like that. From the philosophical point of view, they are liberation through knowledge and freedom from dogma. These are the same motifs of Kantian Enlightenment. Now, the words that Ambedkar uses are harsh and direct. And if you take into consideration that Ambedkar's activity in this book is consistent with the entire project of the Enlightenment, then what need is there of taking offense? What need is there of taking offense? It's like somebody taking offense to Galileo's declaration that the world is not geocentric, the universe is not geocentric. Oh, I find that very offensive. In fact, people found it very offensive. But what do you think about those people who found it offensive? And if you want to be offended, then go ahead. But then just keep in mind and realize that every other book offends people of certain genders, people of certain castes, people of certain religions. We are going to read We from Golwalkar. And I find that offensive to me on every page. Personally offensive. But I read it because we are trying to understand philosophical explorations of Indian modernity, and this is a text that helps us to understand. So you have a choice. You participate in rational freedom and liberation through knowledge, which is what this university was founded for and why you are funded, and why, in some respects, we let others die to let you read. I hope you're choosing to read. Or you can say, okay, I have certain privileges and so on, which I will deploy to feel offended by this book. But you're not the only one with privileges. So each of us has the privilege to be offended, but each of us has the obligation to, the university academic obligation, to know, because that's what this university is here for, and that's why you are engaged in this project. That's why the wall is around you, so that you read things that are difficult to tolerate and that dare you to transcend your dogmas. Now, some people get offended because, as it's argued very widely, Ambedkar offends the sensibilities of Hindus. Well, what would Ambedkar's answer to that be? Who is a Hindu? not attacking me. Who is it that I'm offending? What is a Hindu? Why am I a Hindu? So, if we use this category of religion, and we say that, let's say this is the genus, then there are various species under this. There's Christianity, let's say, Judaism, Islam, and Hinduism. These are species of the genus religion in one supposition. In one supposition. Now, how is any concept or term defined? This is very rudimentary, right? What do? You put the concept into its genus, and then you offer its specific difference. Correct? So, a human being is an animal that, unlike other animals, is discursive, or rational, or whatever. So that's how you define something. So, Christianity is a religion that subscribes to what? Basic tenets, basic principles. Some of them are that Jesus Christ was the incarnation, fleshly embodiment of the monotheistic God, and is the only condition for the salvation, for your soul after death. So, theological and soteriological conditions that are distinct from Islam. Because I didn't mention the Prophet Muhammad or the Quran. You don't have to subscribe to Muhammad being the first amongst all of the prophets to be a Christian. But if you don't, then you're not a Muslim. So, you put the concept under its genus, religion, and its specific difference. So the question that Ambedkar asks is, why am I a Hindu? I know why I'm a Christian, because it's present for me in the definition. I know why I'm a Muslim, it's present for me in the definition. For example, in both Christianity and Islam, monotheism is an essential precondition. Is that a precondition in this thing that we're trying to define, Hinduism? Is it the nature, quantity of God? So Aristotle writes, Ambedkar writes, page 58-65, well, the God is pretty clear. You have Allah through the Prophet Muhammad. Here you have Yahweh. I'm not very good with Zoroastrianism, but from my studies of religion, I believe the God is Ahura Mazda. Is that right? So, in Christianity, God, the so-called Father, incarnated through the Son. Sorry? Of course. Now, what does he say here? Somebody asked me, why am I a Christian? I can give this argument about the God as a specific difference. Someone asked a Muslim, I can give it as a specific difference. Somebody asked a Parsi, I can give it as a specific difference. Somebody asked a Jew, I can give it as a specific difference. Someone asked a so-called Hindu, what do I say? Yes, I'm a monotheist, like each of these so-called religions of Abraham. Vishnu is my God. No. Shiva. No. Krishna. No. Rama. Or am I a polytheist? Or am I an animist? This river. There are a number of difficulties to creating the specific difference to put Hinduism as a species of religion on the basis of God. Sorry, I cross out God, but I'm a philosopher. So, only one person did. Alright. So what then? Is it in my name? Right now I have a proofreader reading one of, indexing one of my books, and his name is Christu John. I'm pretty sure he is a Christian. So, whoever, Muhammad X, Joseph, whatever. Is this where we find my identity? I am a Hindu because I am a Rathor. But there are Buddhist Rathors and there are... This is just not adequate as a differential specific of, right? And this is not a problem. I don't think this is controversial by any stretch of the imagination. Is it where I worship? Temple, synagogue, church. Is that the location, the institutional location? Now, Ambedkar's argument at this moment is, but aren't these sites of exclusion? So what if I'm menstruating? Do I still worship? Am I still a Hindu when I menstruate? What if I am an untouchable? What if only certain people can enter into this temple? Are we then not Hindus? So is Hinduism something that you sometimes are when you're not menstruating and you happen to not be an untouchable? What about my language? Is it my language? I say Ram Ram, you say Salaam Alaikum. Is this what it is? You know that that's not adequate, right? So, what is it basically? Generally, religions are defined by two things. By whether they're monotheistic or not. We don't know what Hinduism is. Because some Hindus are monotheistic, some are pantheistic, some are henotheistic, some are polytheistic, and some are animist. And they all are counted as Hindus. That doesn't work. If I'm a Christian who decides to be an animist, I'm not a Christian. I'm excommunicated. So it's basically that issue, a fundamental priority, and the cardinal tenets, the cardinal doctrine, the cardinal tenets. We know these tenets, right? Like Ten Commandments, whatever, in Buddhism, Three Jewels, in the seven deadly sins. Professions of faith. You have to say this. And until you say this, or until you are baptized or submerged or whatever, you are not. So what are the cardinal tenets of Hinduism? Amongst those who follow Vishnu or Shiva or Krishna or Rama or Kali or Parvati or Lakshmi, do you find the same cardinal tenets? Is it the sacred books? This is an easy one for most of the religions. The sacred books. Everybody knows what they are. So, Bible specifically, the New Testament, the Torah, or as they call it, the Old Testament, the Quran, and for Hinduism, all of you follow the Tantras, right? Oh, wait a minute, none of you. So what have we learned from philosophy? How do you divide up the philosophical schools? As Vedic? Right? So, maybe it's the Vedas. Let's try that. Of course, as you know, as we're going to read in We, what Savarkar and Golarkar decided was that this is a big problem, and so we need a book. Which book? The Gita. It doesn't matter that for four centuries it's not mentioned in Indic literature. It is the definitive, defining text. That's why it is so crucial, precisely because it is a construction. And what is it a construction for? It is a construction to say that no, it is not the case that Hinduism is an effeminate religion that is constantly being conquered by outsiders that have a book. We have a book. But you know that this book is a product of more or less the 1850s onwards. Now, and of course, it's not, I mean, look at your philosophical schools and see if this is adequate. So, this is a problem, but what about the Vedas? Now we're on to something. Now we have what we need to come up with Hinduism as a species of the genus religion. We have the canonical scriptures, the cardinal texts, the sacred books. Now, who are the main gods of the Vedas? Indra, Varuna, Mitra. How many of you worship? How's that possible? We are the gods of the Vedas that are supposed to be the foundation for your religion. There's a little problem. Where have these gods gone? Is it our customs? Customs, you know, vary widely throughout the country. There are no Hindu customs necessarily that everybody can agree upon. Caste? Might it be caste? Maybe this is the thing that gets some coherence of this concept that doesn't have any theistic distinctions, like monotheism, it doesn't have some nominal distinctions, where people with these names, so these names are always Hinduism? Does it have exclusions in location of worship, or the language or expressions that are used, or the cardinal tenets of which we don't know what they are, or the sacred books which have these strange lacunas? So maybe it is caste. And Ambedkar says, you cannot be a Hindu without caste. But we have a problem. Just because you have caste doesn't mean you're a Hindu. We all know that Christians practice caste. As insane as it is to conceptualize theologically, Muslims practice caste. Because it is a cultural product of the Indian subcontinent. So, caste turns out to be unnecessary, but insufficient basis for finding the specific difference of Hinduism from other species of religion. But some progress has been made. Now, why do I not know why I am a Hindu? Why do I not know why I am a Hindu? Or why I'm not a Hindu? Why do I not know that? So what does the Enlightenment tell us? That effects have causes, right? Basically. The relationship between determining cause and effect is advancement in science or philosophy or rationality or reasoning. So we don't just say that we're all here because Indra willed us to be here. Or Varuna. Right? That's not an explanation. That might work in a Vedic, site of worship 2,000 years ago, but it doesn't work in the university. In the university, cause and effect are correlates. And they're subject to discursive rationality. So, Ambedkar asks the question, page 65, why do I not know why I am a Hindu? There must be a reason. There must be a reason why I don't know why I am a Hindu. This is the first riddle of Hinduism. I don't know why I don't know why I am a Hindu, but I know there must be a reason. On page 66, which starts riddle number 6, the other most promising source for what it means to be a Hindu, sacred books, begins to be explored. The title of riddle number 6, which you see on page 66 to 84.
I have a question. Like in riddle first,
yeah.
We see the arguments seem to be flowing in a direction in which Ambedkar first of all is eliminating the certain factors in Hinduism that makes Hinduism a religion, like monotheism, all these things.
Yeah.
And then ultimately he ends up with caste, and then he says that caste can also not be a sufficient condition, because castes are available in other religions existing in subcontinents. In his another book, The Annihilation of Caste, Ambedkar argued how the caste system in Hindus is different from the caste system in other religions like Christianity and Islam, practiced in India.
So
here, for the sake of argument, he is saying that the caste system does not qualify as a sufficient condition because it's available in other religions as well. But in the other place, he is arguing the caste system is different in other religions. So as a different caste system, does it not qualify, like, just for the sake of argument?
I suppose if you want to argue, I would want to know why do you want to argue that. Because you want to prove Ambedkar wrong.
No, that's... I mean, that's not the point, but when someone comes with such a loaded argument, then if you read two texts of the same man, then the apparent incoherency has to be accommodated somewhere.
Okay, so I like what you just said, the apparent incoherency. So let's talk about the Vedas.
Riddle number six is entitled Moral, Spiritual, Value of the Vedas. I'll come back to your statement. It should be entitled Spiritual Moral. Why? Because the moral is discussed on page 74 to 84, and the spiritual is discussed page 66 to 74. Okay, so this is riddle number 6, which is from page 66 to 84 in this book. But we're talking about riddle number 6 in any book, any of the editions. And in this one, first he deals with the spiritual value, so-called spiritual value of the Vedas, and then the so-called moral values.
The premise number these riddles, is there a reason that he's doing
This is an unfinished book. So,
so 2 to 5 are not complete.
No, this is a selection.
Yeah, so just one thing. So Ambedkar's text remains unfinished. Okay? This is a selection of unfinished.
Even in both, I saw that.
Yeah.
One,
yeah. No. The Boz has more riddles. Okay? This is a selection from amongst all of the riddles. But the riddles were unfinished, were incomplete. So the numbering system, I would assume, Ambedkar would have changed. So he would have seen, like any author, he would have seen now what he has, and he would have started organizing it. That's not a controversial thing to say. It's a draft. It is a draft that is motivated by specific historical events. And now that's what I want to mention. The premise of riddle number 6 is the argument, or the supposition, or the claim that the Vedas' teachings are binding and infallible. They're binding and infallible. And we're aware of this in as philosophy students from the ways within which the different so-called schools of philosophy were determined by their fidelity or rejection of the Vedas. So this is a, let's say, a theological political plan, and this is a philosophical arrangement. I'm not saying that it's the absolute philosophical truth, but this is the way that from Dasgupta to Radhakrishnan, from the Orientalists up to your syllabus at JNU is created. That some schools are Nazi. So they are in relation to the theological, political claim of the infallibility and binding nature of the Vedas. No, we reject that. Now, where does this theological, political claim arise? It arises in modernity, in Indian modernity, which we're thinking about philosophically, through the arguments of the Hindu code bill that played out in Parliament from 5th February 1951, when Ambedkar brought push forward the code bill. To 27 September, when Ambedkar resigned, because Stex himself stating that because the people like Nehru didn't come and in support of him against the claims of all of the Congress leaders as well as religious reactionary religious groups against the code bill. So the Hindu Mahasabha, Sardar Patel, the Home Minister, they argued that the changes that Ambedkar is bringing about through the Hindu code bill are in violation of the sanctity of our traditions that are grounded in the Vedas, which are binding and infallible for Hindus. And if you change these binding codes that are given to the Hindus by the Vedas, then you are interfering with the nature of Hinduism and in fact eradicating the foundations of its canonical scripture. Why? Because the Hindu code bill had four distinct orientations. One was about marriage, changing marriage into a contractual relationship, about succession, who can inherit property, about guardianship, and about maintenance, so to divorcees and so on. So in 1937, the British had already introduced the idea that widows, against the Hindu tradition, the so-called Hindu tradition, that widows, so you know that in property inheritance goes to the son, right? Yes. So what about a family where the husband dies, the wife is still living, who gets the house? The son gets the house. And so the mother lives in the house, and just make sure there's another. The wife lives in the house at the pleasure of the son. Now we can say it's not the pleasure, he has an obligation, a duty, all of these traditions of how do you refer to that? Filial piety. Of course, piety refers to the father, so let's say miety, that a son must have. But there were countless cases where the son ejected the so-called mother from the house. So the British introduced that in cases of where the husband dies and there's a widow, that the widow inherits part of the property. It doesn't all go to the son. So the British had already set this standard, but what does Ambedkar want to do? He wants to say, our constitution is built on the principle of equality, and equality means that inheritance has to be divided equally, irrespective of your gender. Gender equality is one of the premises of the constitution, so how is it that in succession we can practice inequalities? Now, the argument was that family is a sacred bond, and the morality built in to the sacred familial bond is originating in the binding and infallible nature of the Vedas, which you cannot change. So if you start to tinker with the Hindu family, then you are tinkering with the Vedas. And if you suggest an egalitarian nature of either inheritance or contractual nature of marriage, then you are basically denying the Vedas, just like a Buddhist would, or a Jain, or a Charvaka. So, divorce, which was one of the things that Ambedkar thought should be the right of a woman to initiate and to execute for reasons such as battery or rape, this group said, no, you can't do that. You're violating the sanctity of the essentially patriarchal family. Now, inheritance of property, the immorality of divorce. Divorce is immoral. The Hindu family is sacred and inalterable. The Hindu family is sacred and inalterable. And why are you trying to alter the nature of this family? Is it because you're an atheist? Is it because you're Charvakin? Is it because you're Buddhist? Is it that you reject the infallibility and binding nature of the Vedas? So in 1951, this is the discussion, the protests that are happening right here in Delhi against Ambedkar, assassination attempts, because he is rejecting, they say, the infallibility and the sacred moral binding nature of the Vedas. So, in 1956, a different moment from when he is writing The Annihilation of Caste, he is reflecting on what is this spiritual and moral content of the Vedas that is so important that we cannot have an egalitarian right of property inheritance or the possibility for seeing marriage as a contract where both the male and the female have equal rights. What is the nature of these Vedas that make it so moral and so spiritual that I cannot alter any of what these people are telling me is their content? Well, let me look at the Vedas and see what is it teaching me, because I should learn about the moral and spiritual content of the Vedas so I can understand why it is that we can't introduce succession and equality because we will then threaten the sacred fabric of the Hindu family. And so that's why from page 66 to 74 it begins with what are the Vedas' spiritual content? He doesn't know. He tried to know. As you know, he tried to study Sanskrit and the Vedas in India, but he was not allowed because he was a Mahar. So instead, when he left India, he joined Bonn and studied Sanskrit in Germany, where they didn't exclude him from studying. Now, in 19th century Indology, the kinds of work that actually created that scenario before that Hinduism is a religion, a species of religion just like all of the others. This kind of Indological thinking had certain biases packed into it. One of the biases was stasis. Indian civilization is static and unchanging. This is a portrait that Hegel gives. This is a portrait that most of the Indologists basically give. And it is one in some respects that even philosophers like Radhakrishna agree with. Because we don't have contemporary Indian philosophy. Can you name for me, let's say, 10 very innovative contemporary Indian philosophers? But you can easily name 10 contemporary so-called Western philosophers. Why is that? Because everything that was important to be produced was produced 1,000 years ago. The wisdom was achieved and it's now just our job to study it, to learn it. So Radhakrishna is an example of an Orientalist kind of thinking about this issue, because those who would seek to introduce a conception of progressive Indian philosophy are denying the static nature that the wisdom was already achieved 1,000 years ago, or 2,000 years ago, or as some NRIs like to say, 40,000 years ago with our Vedas and so on. Anyway, so 19th century Indology had this bias against Indian thought that it was static. And that bias has remained even on your syllabus. Is that not true? Do you study contemporary Indian philosophers on your syllabus, or do you stick when you're learning Indian philosophy to the six schools? Now, Ambedkar says India was not static at all. It was never static. And this is amazing because, as you probably know, the general assumption is that Ambedkar was a modernizer and introduced a lot of Western ideas into India.
So this bias came out
of Orientalist scholarship. Now, the intriguing thing is that Ambedkar rejects this Orientalist scholarship and says there's nothing static about the way Indian thought has evolved. And so the next two riddles, that we are discussing, riddle number 13 and riddle number 14, are showing, in fact, that Indian thought has changed from one of ahimsa to ahimsa in a post-Vedic period. And has changed from ahimsa back to ahimsa in a post-dharmashastra period. Now, if you can have a change of what seem to be fundamental beliefs, because we're still in the quest for what makes you a Hindu, and a large part of that, Gandhi's position, is of course ahimsa.
What is post-dharmashastra period?
So after Manusmriti.
Here it is.
The historical era? That's open to question, right? Because 200 BC to 200 AD, nobody agrees on that. Now the opening line of, let's say, let me just give you the page number 66. So the opening parts of riddle number 6. Modern writers have expressed views which deny any spiritual value. Which modern writers? Orientalist Indologists. So is Ambedkar going to side with them? No, because he recognizes their bias. So he says, it would be no doubt be objected that all foreign scholars are prejudiced and that their views therefore cannot be accepted. Fortunately, we're not altogether dependent upon the views of foreigners. There are leaders of indigenous schools of thought which have taken the same view. The most notorious example is that of the Charvaks. Okay. Now, and of course the other Gnostic systems. Now there's something that I want you to see, which is absolutely crucial, on page 69 of this version. While quoting Vedic articulations of Avedic positions, specifically of Lokayata, this statement is used. You know what I'm talking about, right? The Orthodox schools say, this school says this, these are their arguments, and then we deny it like this. So this is said by an Orthodox school, but it's articulating the argument of the heterodox school. It says, the three Vedas, the ascetic three staves, and smearing oneself with ashes, Raspati says, these are but means of livelihood for those who have no manliness or sense. What does that mean? But means of livelihood. It is an economic interpretation of the vested interests of the priestly community. You understand that this is the argument of Lokayata. Now go back to the introduction. one of the reasons that this book is not allowed to be taught in universities, that they consider banning it, is because on page 51, at the top, that means in Ambedkar's introduction, he says, one may well ask them, where is Indra? Where is Varuna? Remember the one who says that the Vedas are the source, the canonical source of Hinduism? They have all disappeared. And why? Because the worship of Indra, Varuna, and Brahma have ceased to be profitable. Have ceased to be profitable. And then down at the bottom, indeed, the Brahmins have made religion a matter of trade and commerce. And then there's that funny part where he says, even the Jews are more faithful to their religion. That's a common stereotype, that the Jews are interested in money as opposed to religion, right? That's how they're always represented as seeking gold and so on. In Shakespeare's Merchant of Venice, Shylock is more interested in money than in his daughter. This is very offensive, we think, for Ambedkar to say. But what have I just noticed on page 69? It is not Ambedkar who says it. It is the indigenous school of Indian philosophy known as Lokayata. Thanks. So shall we ban Gnostic philosophy? Page 66. We can't take the modern writer, the Orientalists. We can look at the Charvak in the Lokayata school, and he does that. And some of the arguments that come from when the Mimamsa school is suggesting what other Gnostic schools are saying, in this case we don't know what is the Gnostic school, they're arguing against the eternal nature of the Vedas by saying it cannot be eternal because we observe persons who are not eternal in the Vedas. These are just a variety of arguments being proposed. You read philosophy and you see that they come up with all kinds of arguments in Indian philosophy. Where is the line? You remember this line that the Vedas are full of falsehoods, self-contradiction, and tautology?
68.
In this book?
70.
Okay, I'm still not finding it. But anyway, let's... The three faults, yes. So this is the Gnostic position. It's an ancient position contemporaneous with Orthodox schools articulating the infallible nature of the Vedas. And then, where's the other when Ambedkar himself says it? There's a point where it's not in the book, right? Or is it always said through somebody else's words? Then it doesn't matter.
It's here. It's in the front page. This one.
Okay. Yeah. So this kind of goading, antagonistic cover. The Vedas are a worthless set of books. There's no reason either to call them sacred or infallible. These are arguments that Ambedkar is laying out that come from a history of philosophical disputation. It's not just the prejudices of a hyper-modern rationalist man. Now, so much for the spiritual content, which gets summarized as being full of falsehoods. Spiritual content shouldn't be that. Full of self-contradiction and full of tautology. As opposed to infallible. Infallible is the opposite of self-contradictory. It's self-contradictory to say that something is wrong and infallible. Right? This is just logical application of logic. So within the spiritual content, Ambedkar's argument is that both foreigners and indigenous schools of Gnostic philosophy have argued against the spiritual content of the Vedas being grounded in infallibility. It's not much of an argument. It's just a step. So things start to pick up on page 74. And why do they start to pick up on page 74? Because of the Hindu code. Ambedkar is messing with the moral, spiritual, sacred nature of the Hindu family that is grounded in the moral, spiritual nature of the infallible Vedas. So what is the moral content of the Vedas for somebody like me, Ambedkar says, who is not allowed to learn it in the university in India? Let me read it myself. So who did that? What does that describe? A Lutheran movement, Protestant movement. Let me not go through the priests because they won't let me. They will deceive me. They have an economic motive. Remember the Protestant Lutheran rhyme? What was it? When the gold in the coffer chinks, the soul to heaven springs. Right?
Yeah. Went to the door of a German church.
Yeah, the 99 theses. But what I'm saying is there was a common rhyme or a ditty that was told that basically when you put money in the priest's, Catholic priest's coffer and it makes that ching, that noise, when you hear that noise, that's your soul going to heaven. You've just purchased that.